È stata una scelta deliberata quella di non far vedere mai lo squalo giaguaro.
Was it a deliberate choice never to show the jaguar shark?
No, I dropped the camera.
No, ho perso la macchina da presa, mi è caduta.
Why are they laughing?
It's a documentary. It's all really happening.
Klaus, why aren't you rolling?
Could I have a word with you, please?
Why aren't you getting this?
I never spend any time on anybody else's movie sets but my own. I didn't learn the way you do the stuff. I love to have people around where whatever weird thing I'm gonna ask for or whatever wrong way I'm gonna approach something isn't gonna surprise them or throw them off. They're gonna be able to accommodate that and, you know, and hopefully they'll be able to, like, to enjoy that. And so the people I work with, they know how we kind of do this, and they know what degree to which things are gonna be off the cuff.
Não tem problema se no barco tem cheiro forte de peixe cru. Todos vão cantar meu rock blue. Enquanto o chefe toma banho na praia totalmente.
And the pants may be a little shorter, a little less break in the
yeah.
pants.
We can't make them wider at the bottom because we have no more material.
A lot of the iconic costumes in the movie were conceived by Wes and Noah and put into the screenplay. But the work that Mulane has done to realize those and to bring all sorts of other ideas to the story have been great.
We have the brilliant Mulane Cananero, who I've been a huge fan of since she did The Shining. She's the kind of costume person that calls you up and inspires you on the telephone way long before you ever come to do a film. And in this case, Mulane said, you know, you're playing Eleanor, and, you know, I think it would be very beautiful to have blue hair, you know, and that's number one, and you start to get interested. And then she says, and maybe you have green eyes, you know. I saw something very beautiful in Morocco where they put blue on the inside of the eyes. So you already kind of get electrified by what she has to say long before you come to set.
The element that I love most about the costumes is the caps, the Team Zissou caps. Seeing them en masse, they're a bunch of red caps, and how sweet. But then if you look closely, everyone's cap is slightly different, and they've all got their own sort of signature. Like, Bill looks like a Smurf. And Willem's got a pom-pom, and it's really sweet.
I think this was Wes's idea, if this could be an idea. But he does give you room to add personal touches. But in the end, it's got to be something that he really responds to. He doesn't really indulge people's personal fantasies unless they align with his. You know, in some projects, you actually work with the designer, you work with the director to talk about what you need. That happens very much after the fact. I'm pretty much shown a picture, a cartoon of who Klaus is, and I'm told to be it, activate it. I mean, not that directly, but that's my sense of it.
Put him for 12!
It's hard sometimes, yeah, to see where Steve Zissou ends and where Bill Murray begins. And Bill's very comfortable walking around in a Speedo, or, you know, things that you don't, you know, think of American men, kind of. I guess in Europe they wear Speedos, but Bill is kind of to the manner born. He loves kind of sporting a Speedo. I don't know, more power to him. He's a better man than me.
Let me tell you about my boat. The Belafonte was a long-range sub-hunter during the Second World War, which we bought from the U.S. Navy for $900,000.
The sequence with the boat that's chopped in half was an amazing experience to shoot because it was like a play.
From the beginning, Wes had it in his mind that we would be building half the boat lengthwise in cross-sections.
And as we shot it, all the actors are walking around in this ant colony.
So you see characters run up all in the one shot, moving up and down staircases.
And you see the boat, and you see the giant set of the boat. It's enormous.
It's 40 feet tall. It's 150 feet long. It's longer than a city block.
What are you doing here? I thought all you interns ran out on me.
I want to help you find that shark.
God damn it. Thank you, intern. You're getting an A.
His name's Nico.
Who?
Hello, Vikram.
Give me that camera. I'm gonna smash it over your head.
The mission was to convey a sense of having traveled across the world without going farther from Rome than Naples.
There's something very Italian and European which has kind of crept into this film and made it kind of made of a unique fabric that it wouldn't feel the same if it was made in America, and you could get, even if you had locations that looked similar, I think that flavor is actually a powerful force in the film.
This world is Wes's reality. Wes's reality is, and when I say that, I mean, it's not a period movie, but nothing's new. It's in Europe, it's on the Mediterranean. The places are Loquasto, but it's not Italy. They're almost, on one hand, genericized versions of these places or fable-like descriptions of these places. And on the other hand, they're very textured. They're not two-dimensional, they're three-dimensional. The other element is the underwater world. That's the place where we were able to be fantastic.
Underwater photography that's being done these days is so incredible that we're never really going to be able to top what's been done. You know, we've just seen the stuff they do in the Bahamas or they do with these incredible cameras. And a lot of times one's instinct is, well, you know, let's find the best thing and try and top that. And I think that's, in general, a lot of the way people in Hollywood kind of think. And I think Wes was very savvy in immediately recognizing that, well, we're not going to be able to top that. So he came up with a whole different idea, which was to create a unique undersea world.
My mission was to create a world that they inhabit that was somewhere between a science facility and a summer camp. And that was really how we looked at it. The compound, the place where they reside, their home base, has a pool with a killer whale in it. But it has a 12th century castle. It has seaplanes landing, but the ping pong table is really the central place there. I think that there's a I won't grow up quality to this world of Zissou.
Stop motion animation is an ancient form of animation. It goes back to the very beginning of trick film photography. And, you know, there's a handful of people in the world who have specialized in this strange form of animation. And they are the animators, they are actors, and they're actually doing a performance from beginning to end, but in very slow motion through their puppets. So you have a character like myself, you know, I'm imagine me as an animal with arms, and you need to have a hand reach out to here, come back, and clap. An animator will come in there and grab this, if I'm the puppet, grab it and move it about that much, take a frame, another frame, another frame, another frame, another frame. So slow out there to get a pose, you get a lot of frames there, move back quickly, you take bigger motions. So it's a successive series of stills, and if there's a complex character, say the crabs in Life Aquatic, which have eight limbs and they're crawling around, you have to think crab. You have to imagine, how does something with that many legs move around? It's not a person. It's not something you can just feel yourself. So it's an arcane but highly fascinating and beautiful way to bring things to life. A lot of the creatures in this film are just slightly different than reality.
He brought your present. A crayon ponyfish. Wow. Interesting specimen.
Now, I've got more of a cartoon background, even if it's stop motion. I'm used to larger exaggeration. Wes is more interested in subtle exaggeration.
his sense of humor is a little more, I don't know, delicate. And you know, I really admire it, but it makes it a lot harder for us. It takes a few weeks to get used to Wes's aesthetic. You kind of can't believe it at first, but then eventually you start to see the value and clarity of it, and then you go for it.
This was not a stop-motion puppet. This was a puppet that we put in a water tank. It was a water puppet, and it had to be really flexible. And basically, Miguel sculpted this so that it would have already, would be already be kind of in a swimming position. So when we put it in the tank, we had a little umbrella, a mechanical umbrella over here, that basically can be pulled, and all that each tentacle was anchored on one of these, and basically it was pulled through the water, so it could swim realistically. So you have to see, it was supposed to be 4 or 5 feet long. And when the animator animated this, it swam through the water really slowly, and then its head moves really slowly, so it gives a lot of illusion of mass. And this was an interesting puppet also because it's supposed to have this little sub on its back with a little camera inside. There's a little light sticking through the head. So when we did it, we made a hollow shell inside with, you can see it being opened up. This little electronics inside.
This is the jaguar shark. This is probably the biggest stop-motion puppet that's ever been created. When you're shooting things that are supposed to look like they're swimming, and if it's this big and heavy, you want it to sag against gravity. So upside down makes it look more like it's in water. It's one thing to shoot spaceships, which is a tradition here at ILM, but to create organic motion on all these creatures is a whole nother art, and I think the guys have done a great job at that.
Some of these creatures under the water are something to see.
There's personality in stop motion. It feels handmade. Henry Selick, he's somebody who I've admired, and he brings his own artistry into it, and he's like another actor.
The challenge was to not overuse them, to not make it something that seemed either too cute or manipulative on our part, you know, cut to the cute fish.
I don't know if you would describe this surreal, but it's a world that Wes creates, sort of like the Royal Tenenbaums, slightly artificial, but I think within that world, the emotions and the feelings are, you know, very real.
Does this seem fake?
How dare you?
The line that we're treading in this story is it a comic book, or is it a fable? Is it a timeless story? Is it a very specific story about this man and his feelings? And it's both, and that's what's amazing about it. It's sometimes tongue-in-cheek comic. It's Bill Murray. And the other times, it's the most tender, emotional, really true, personally felt storytelling. Underwater, I love you. Jimmy says, ooh. Underwater, I love you. Jimmy says, ooh. I love you, I love you.
Esse é o grande controle da Major Town, e disso eu pensei, na verdade quase.